Welcome once again. We're really going to get cooking on this one. Very windy day here. I had everything completely immaculately manicured, of course, yesterday, finally, and overnight a massive windstorm, now just a complete mess everywhere. Of course, by design. We live in the age of idolatry. That is the age we live in. Idolatry is an incredible problem. It is a planetary problem. It is the problem that was foretold in prophecy, that the world would return to idolatry. And the more we understand what this means, the clearer we'll be able to accept the remedy to this, which I say is most likely relocation, because when idolatry gains the upper hand, as it has already, what happens is it ends up playing off factions against themselves, dividing and conquering, creating enmity between groups, and fostering conflict and destruction. That's what idols do. Absolutely terrible situation we're in the world, and most people don't realize it, because they go to idols and they say, idol, what do you think about the world situation? The idol says, oh my gosh, everyone's going to be enlightened. It's incredible time. How fortunate you are to be here. And you say, oh, thank you, idol. Not realizing that the idols are plotting your death as they're giving you this nonsense. Now, what are idols? Idols are basically simply our own, something that we have imagined to be an authority over us, other than God. It's as if our own imagination is pretending, we're imagining that our imagination has power over us and has authority over us, and therefore gives us accurate guidance and the right kind of guidance, how to be safe. Idols essentially are a way to hide from God, advice to us as to how to hide from God, and thus we think avoid being annihilated. Because since we're trying to annihilate God, we assume through projection that God is trying to annihilate us. Not true. The gospel, the good news is that's not the slightest bit true. God pays no attention to our silly little games, the same way we don't pay attention to games of a little child in a sandbox, saying, oh, I'm going to destroy the castle, I'm going to destroy the house. And we say, what's that? They say, oh, that's the house. And then what's that? Oh, that's a truck that's going to come and destroy the house. Do we shake in fear because our house is going to be destroyed? No, we know it's just fantasy in a sandbox. So the good news is God has paid no judgment whatsoever on our dreams. Just a smile and a dismissal, no judgment. And knows that we are, as we were created to be, perfect and flawless. We are reality. And yet, in our ignorance and our pride and our confusion and our attempt to become prime creator, wanting to displace God and become prime creator, we want to create our own reality, a separate reality. We assume that God is trying to annihilate us. So idols are something that we have made, like programmed to give us guidance at all times. It's like a program, like a computer program almost, to give us guidance at all times, never failing to tell us, do this, do this, do this, do this. And then we obey the idols as if they were God. But what we really obey them, because we believe they're going to help us escape annihilation from God. So, this is completely nuts, completely insane. There's no reason to fear God whatsoever. There's no reason to fear annihilation from God whatsoever. This is the gospel. The gospel of good news comes into a world that is full of idolatry, of people who are following idols, and shares the good news. But it doesn't always take very well. Like Jesus said, you scatter mustard seeds and some fall on fertile soil, some fall on stones, you know. That's a fact. The teacher is the Holy Spirit. When we're not listening to idols, we're listening to the Holy Spirit. Now, what idols do is they tell us there's a third option. And the idols say, okay, let's make a deal. And this is what idols say. They say, I'll give you permission not to listen to me, to idols. The idol says this, I'll give you permission not to listen to me if you agree not to listen to the Holy Spirit. You think, okay, that's fair. That's like saying, I'll give you permission to drop lies as long as you drop truth. And you think, oh, that's okay, that's not a bad deal. Now, wait a minute. Something is either a lie or it's true. Okay. There isn't a third option. The whole game, the way the idols really control you is by making this so-called deal, telling you there's a third option between truth and lies, between hypotheticals and reality. There is no third option. There is no third option. This is super important. You cannot overstate the importance of this, and I reinforce this in many, many videos. There is no, something's either it's true or it's not true. It's like saying endlessness or finiteness. Infiniteness or finiteness. Is there some third option that's neither that one or that one? There is not. There is not. How about perfect non-judgment? Okay, perfect non-judgment or judgment? Is there some third option that's neither one of those? Answer is no. No, no, and no. So, idols speak of fear. The Holy Spirit speaks of no fear. Okay, no fear of God. Idols speak of fear of God. Holy Spirit speaks of no fear of God. When we decide that we're going to drop some part of listening to idols, give them a moment not to listen to idols, not to listen to fear of God, the Holy Spirit is instantly always there to speak of no fear of God. Either there's reason to fear God or there is not. Either reality is permanent or it's impermanent. There's no third option. There is no third option. The idols say, well, it's permanent for now, but later it will end. That's impermanence. That's impermanence. So, idols are severe. Their logic is crazy. Very, very badly flawed. And yet, in order to get this continuous guidance from them, which we feel is protecting us from annihilation, we overlook the flaws and the stuff that doesn't add up at all. We overlook it. We just say, oh, that's okay, no big deal, because it's we think it's helping save us. We think that idols bring salvation. So the world right now, again, is in the age of idolatry. We have backslid into idolatry severely, catastrophically, so badly that what I get from the Holy Spirit is relocation. That those who do not want refuse to turn to idols, should relocate to another place other than this world. This world is going to be given over to destructivity, because that's what idols bring. Idols, their purpose is really destructivity, because destructivity witnesses to hypotheticals, is a way of forgetting reality. When you're immersed in all this conflict and stuff, your mind tends not to think about reality and God and how and wanting to go back home. You're so freaked out. There's death, destruction everywhere. And you see, idols don't want us to even think about reality. Even the notion don't want us to think about it. So it gives us something that's utterly alien and to reality. Destructivity, death, terrible tragedies everywhere. Totally alien to reality. And so when our attention is on this, we it's as if we completely forget about reality, which is what we want. You see, idols tell us that we can be so immersed in trying to in this world, in the hypothetical dreams of impermanence, that we will completely forget about reality, and in doing so, reality will cease to exist. It will be no more when we forget about it entirely. So it tries to get us to forget about reality, forget about our home, forget about our identity, forget about all that stuff, and just pay attention to the world. Pay attention to the world. Pay attention to what's happening in the world. And of course, if there's all these wars and conflicts and stuff, you are, desperately searching for survival. You're focused on the world. There's lots of other reasons. Idols sow conflict. They sow divisiveness. They pit people against each other. They stir up agitation. Okay. And of course, those who follow the guidance of idols, they're experts at that. And so this world was sunk in severe idolatry several thousand years ago. And prior to that, in many parts of the world, you had idolatry. Idolatry. Prior to the coming of Christ here, the world was enmeshed in the most severe idolatry. And with the coming of Jesus and also Buddha, various spiritual teachers came at the time of severe idolatry and helped move the planet towards truth, away from the fear of God. And over the last several thousand years, that's been something that the world has been considering. How about if we, turn to the Holy Spirit instead of idols, and considering this, and some have been trying to do this, whereas others have simply been waiting. A great many have simply waited, and it's kind of like they felt they've been imprisoned, disempowered, where idols are no longer worshipped. And so you remember the Roman Empire and all the statues of idols, so they've just been waiting and waiting and waiting. Sure, they go to church. They pretend to be religious, etc. All these thousands of years, but they're not. They're not. They're just putting on an act. They're just waiting until a time when the idols would return. In other words, give them the guidance where they could reconnect with the guidance. So what happened is in these recent times is that's exactly what happened. Is idolatry has returned with a vengeance. The 60s was a time when it really took place. 60s, 70s, sex, drugs, and rock and roll was the way, was the toe in the door. We said, hey, the idols, if we listen to them, they'll teach us how to have fun again, because the 50s are very uptight. It was very Cold War-ish. It was very corporate. It was everyone was locked into rigid roles, and people got antsy. They said, wow, we're kind of being suffocated by this, military industrial complex. And they just wanted to have fun. The Cold War was horrible. It's worse than war in a lot of ways. Cold War was just awful, thinking that in any day you're going to get the world's going to go up in a nuclear war. It's worse than anything, in my opinion. It's worse than World War II. Worse than any wars that ever taken place was the Cold War. And I'm a Cold War baby. So I grew up in the Cold War. Because we literally felt that the world was going to be entirely destroyed any moment, any day. We just didn't know that when, from nuclear, all-out nuclear war between the Soviet Union and the United States. And we were just on the edge of our seats in terror, So into that dread, people just finally said, you know what? We just can't take this anymore. We just can't take this anymore. We just want to have fun. My gosh. We just want to divert our minds from that. So into that opening came the return of idolatry, and the idols began, people began to reconnect with idolatry, and the idols began advising them on what to do. And they began following that advice. And then from that point on, it's been like an avalanche. Just a free fall into idolatry, actually. A free fall. Now, of course, we're talking about this, and we're spilling the beans on idolatry. We need to do that. Also, along that time, we had a desperate need. We were reconnecting with idols, and we felt, how do we do this? How do we do this? I mean, it's been so long. We've been considering, we've been not paying attention to idols for a long time. Not so much, at least. How do we really get back in the good graces of idols? How do we do it? We need leaders. We need those who know how to do this. See, this is where the plot really thickened. That's where feminism came into its own. A certain new style of feminism. Feminism before was a different thing, but a new virulent type of strain of feminism came in, who were the experts at reconnecting with idols, because they had never really left idolatry. They were just pretending. Because see, in the past, before the quote unquote patriarchal religions, the religions Christ centered, Buddhist centered, etc., religions, Judaism, etc., it was a matriarchy. The females were in charge of idolatry, and for a long time. And so when Christianity came along, and these monotheist religions and Buddhist teachings, etc., they supplanted, people started to go away from idolatry. And this has caused, you know, an enormous resentment among those, the priestesses and the high priestesses and the those who controlled the public and people's minds through idolatry. They greatly resented this, and so they bided their time and maintained connection with idols. So we come in here to the 1960s, and what happened was this strain throughout history suddenly began to grow like a cancer, and they had all these people, many of them women, some men, but the leaders were women, feminists, who said, hey, we know how to connect with idols. We're experts at it. We'll show you the way. We'll take the lead now. And so what literally the planet is now being led by these idolatrous feminist ideology idolaters who have convinced the world that they have the answer. They know how to, they're intercessors with idols. This essentially what's happened. It's the new priesthood. It's really the priestesshood, and the sisterhood is what it is. And they are ruling the roost right now in this world, because we feel the way to be safe is to get guidance from idols, and they're experts at that, and how to connect us with our inner idols, as it were. That's literally the situation that's taking place. Let me change this a little bit, and you can digest what is being said, which is something that is not being said very often in this world, simply be for fear of this the priestesshood, the idolaters, who are now following the advice of idols to an extraordinary extent. And you can tell in the world how polarized the world's become. That's because of idolatry. The idols are trying to pit religions against each other, like Christianity and Islam, and Islam and Judaism and various factions. Is trying to split the world in all these different factions, so that there's big conflict, big war, big death, big suffering, big misery, so we forget about reality. You see, it's all by design. So once a toehold, foot in the door with sex, drugs, and rock and roll, the idols say, hey, you guys, you don't realize how much fun idolatry is. Look how miserable your life is. Yeah, you wake up every day, you get up, and you think, oh, we're going to be killed by nuclear war. And we're so straitjacketed and uptight. You know, they always say, you're uptight. And they say, here's drugs. Free love. Free sex, no consequences. Here's the birth control pills. Here's the drugs. Here's the music. Let's just let your hair down. Let's just party. You know, and so that got the foot in the door. And from there, it began to develop, and then the high technology eventually came into the picture after a whole bunch of drugs had really caused so many problems. The massive problem with cocaine, then crack cocaine, and there's so many drugs pouring in, and now there's methamphetamine. There's so many drugs. And all the so-called liberation, women's liberation, and all that kind of stuff, it made people think, hey, idolatry's not so bad. Hey, look at this. I mean, these women are like prostitutes almost, really. Absolutely. Except it's all free kind of thing. And it said, wow, idolatry is wonderful. I mean, look at all this music is so great, and all these women are just like totally loose and grooving and just having a wild time, and it's like freedom from all our anxiety and suffering and fear and misery and all this concern, because we just party. Life's a party. So idolatry got its foot in the door, and then it brought in the high technology, okay, which brings in the notion of, hey, we can all be connected, we can all tweet, you know, we can all connect, we can social media, all this kind of stuff that makes us feel that we're so sophisticated and connected and supposedly all one. That's part of the distraction of idolatry, is offering this ridiculous substitute for what the Holy Spirit has to offer us. So, and also it brings in a totalitarian control system, which idolatry wants. It brings in revolutions, which is what idolatry wants. Idolatry wants chaos. It wants chaos. Okay, its goal is chaos. Its goal is chaos. So sure, it starts out with sex, drugs, and rock and roll, which is a type of controlled chaos. It really is very chaotic. The 60s, 70s, very chaotic, actually. It was terribly chaotic. But when you're young, you think it's fun. You see, youth kind of likes a bunch of chaos going on. Like I said, wow, I'm quick, I'm supple, I can react to this and this and this. And it's kind of like a challenge. It's like a challenge. But the older people said, hey, wait a minute. This is idolatry. You guys are going the wrong direction. And they were right. They were right. They were right. And of course, they got criticized severely. Severely. Like the establishment, these old stupid Christians, they're uptight, man. They're so uptight, you know. They're uptight. They don't know what they're talking about. We're having fun, and look at them. They're poor, rigid lives and stuff. Yeah, well, they turned out to be right. So this chaos is gathering momentum more and more and more. We're becoming better and better and better and better at bringing about chaos, which is the goal of idolatry, so that we have no idea about reality at all. When you're in a very chaotic state, you cannot remember reality. Okay, I know, I've been there, and you say, I'm lost. I'm totally lost, which is what idolatry wants you to feel. Idols want you to feel that you're just completely lost, and you don't have a clue, and you're just no idea what's going on at all. Just total mental state of total chaos. That's what they're aiming for. That's what they want in the world. That is what they're trying to bring. They're trying to disempower everybody to the point of chaos. Which is not a good thing at all. Not a good thing at all, because you're not able, you have very difficult time to consider truth. The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has a very simple message, but it has no exceptions to it. And when you're in chaos, you think everything's an exception. Everything's an exception to everything. It just is a state of completely, you know, total exceptions to everything. Very bad state. So the world has gone all in for idolatry now, all in. And if you want to have any foot in this world at all, any footprint at all, you need to bow to the ideology of idols. And again, idols are just simply devices we have made, like programming, like they talk about the Matrix or something. Programming we've imagined to this authority over us. It's just imaginary, but it's our own thoughts coming, seeming to come to us from another source other than ourselves. You see, we don't recognize them as our own thoughts, and it's our own guidance of how to hide from God so we're not annihilated. And we're very clever at this hiding. Very, very clever at it. So we turn more and more to the flesh, more and more to the dancing and the singing and the drinking and the whining and the dining and the sex and the drugs and all that kind of stuff. More and more to the flesh. And these high priestesses of the flesh are everywhere now, everywhere, giving everybody advice and gossiping and showing off their glamorous bodies and their attitudes and their hedonistic attitudes of idolatry. Idolatrous attitudes. It's saturated, it's permeated the whole civilization, the whole planet now is absolutely saturated with that. And getting quantumly worse all the time, every moment actually. And it's said that the world is drunk on the wine of that great whore of Babylon, you know, which is talking about an idol. Okay. And the world is extraordinarily drunk on that wine right now. Staggering. Staggering. And it will follow the advice of the idols, which is to go towards chaos. It's obvious the world's going towards chaos, chaotic situation. Just look at the future. My gosh. So it's not something that anybody who wants peace of mind is interested in. The future of this planet is not something that any sane person that would be interested in. But there's a whole army of those who keep claiming, from the advice of idols, they say, hey, idol, what's the future going to be like? And the idol says, oh, wonderful, wonderful, you're going to love it. Of course. What do you want? What else are idols going to say? So, I gotta kick the cat off of here. Hey, what else are idols going to say? Of course they're going to tell you that. What they don't tell you is going to be extremely chaotic. Extremely gruesome. That's a fact. Future of this planet is extremely gruesome, extremely chaotic. So anyone of a sane, right mind would be saying, hey, let's relocate. Let's get out of this place. You know? Let's get out while the getting out is good. And yet this is something the idols will never tell you. Or if they do, they'll mix it all up in confusing ways. So it's rarely talked about in this world. It's amazing. Almost nobody is even considering, wait a minute, if the future of this planet is so terrible, why the heck don't we think about going somewhere else? And of course, idols tell us, well, you can't go anywhere else. You know, you're stuck here. No, you're not. That's the advice of idols again. Liars and deceivers from the very beginning. Jesus lumps all these idols together into, quote unquote, the ego, which is just the sum total of all idolatrous advice. Advice that we are giving ourselves, but seeming that it comes from some higher authority, you know, like God is speaking to us and telling us what to do, or some inner voice or something is telling us that we need to do this or that. And then listening to that inner voice instead of the Holy Spirit, which speaks for us, which is our advocate for is. Our true advocate for truth, for reality, for telling us the good news that the continuity problem was solved from the very beginning and it's never been a problem for us, and tells us about relocation, tells us all this stuff. That is the Holy Spirit. It clarifies truth for us beautifully and perfectly, flawlessly. So we have, the world has turned to idols, idolatry. The leaders of the world, very idolatrous, very much so. Totally obvious for those who know, who are aware of what's going on. It's just obvious. You know, you can tell, hey, is this leader following a devotee of the Holy Spirit or a devotee of idols? You know, how long does it take? It's obvious. Totally obvious. Which is a terrible, terrible thing for this planet. And so as all the leaders and the bureaucracy of the planet becomes idolatrous, the pressure goes on to the people to follow their lead, as if that were salvation. You see, we think idols are giving us salvation. So to not follow them seems to be folly, seems to be crazy. But they're not. They're offering us continued damnation, living in dread and fear and cowering, hiding in some dark hole somewhere, you know, shivering and trembling, thinking God is going to find them at any moment and annihilate them. So it's a dreadful life, actually. The idolatrous life is a dreadful life. Now, people insist they can't give up their idols, etc. And so when you try to help people, you tend to end up agreeing with idols just to, you know, try to show them that you're not against them or something. But that doesn't work. It doesn't work. The fact is that only the Holy Spirit knows how to free us from idols. We ourselves don't know how to do it. You need a flawless advocate, and the Holy Spirit is that. But so there's only one teacher, and that's the Holy Spirit. The rest of us are just props and assistants and supporting cast of the Holy Spirit. Absolutely. Just showcasing the effectiveness of the Holy Spirit. That's all we are, but we're not teachers. We're not guru. There's only one guru, and that's the Holy Spirit. That's a fact. There's only one teacher, one guru, one savior. It's the Holy Spirit is that, because it has perfect use of time. See, it was created to be able to use time perfectly, to set time down, for us to set time down perfectly. So it has flawlessly knows how to use time perfectly. And only that is capable of turning the tide against the idols and convincing us to not heed their advice anymore, their dreadful advice. So these are the times that we've been warned about, the times of the Great Tribulation, the time when idolatry will bring about massive confusion on this planet, massive chaos. And idols, of course, will bring some of their friends, meaning cosmic occurrences, on this planet too, to heighten the chaos. And so for those of us who don't want that, relocation, relocation, relocation. That continues to be the theme. When I ask the Holy Spirit, what's most important? Relocation comes up. Get off this planet, go to another planet, or another, go to another dwelling place. Idolatry is not always so much in fashion as it is here now in this world. This world has reached a bottom point. It's the Kali Yuga. It's the Dark Ages. It is a time of utmost peril. Not all dwelling places are locked into such despair and darkness. And some are very, very, very fine indeed. What we need is a place where we're able to encourage and can feel more encouraged to listen to the Holy Spirit and have the Holy Spirit clarify for us the truth, which I can testify to. The Holy Spirit is perfectly adept at that and has clarified for me the essential, what essentially needs to be clarified. And the Holy Spirit says, just look here, look, don't be afraid, go ahead and look at there. And you look and you see and say, ah, God is not angry at us. God is not threatened by our dreams. You can see it. I've seen it. And then you see the continuity problem has been solved. It was concurrent. God gave the non-perfect non-judgment upon all hypotheticals concurrently with the arising of the first hypothetical of hypotheticalness. It was concurrent. So that's solved. No problem, no problem, no problem. You check out this and you look, and you see there's no problem. The Holy Spirit just says, look here, and helps you gain the courage to do so. And then you look and you say, hey, wait a minute, there's no problem there. And the Holy Spirit says, that's right, there's never been a problem there. And you see it, and you say, you're right, I agree, I see it. And then the Holy Spirit says, well, look here. And you look there, and you say, huh, no problem there either. That's great. So that's what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit just helps you look at what is already the case. Okay, it's your assurance and support. And it has this way of gradually building up your confidence and courage to look. That's it. That's it. That's what it did to me. It's all it did was just gradually build up my courage so that I could take a look at where I've been terrified to look before. So many places are terrified. I'm sure that destruction is annihilation is lurking right there. And then I look at it and I say, huh? Yeah, there's no problem at all. There's no annihilation there. What was I afraid of? Wow. It's like that. It's just like that. That's the spiritual path, is you just looking at what is, and then you see, oh, God's not mad at us. We never threaten God. We never threaten reality. There's no reprisals. God's not hiding some reprisals for us, some secret sneak attack towards us, nothing like that. No, not true. God never paid any attention to dreams, paid no attention to them whatsoever. Not reacting to them, not paying any attention to them, not the slightest bit interested in them, none of that. So God is still in the same perfect spirit as always, totally joyous and blissful and unconcerned, as is all of reality. Same thing with all of reality. Not the slightest bit concerned about over dreams of its destruction or hypothetical what-if imaginings. Not the slightest bit. As never has been, never will be. So again, no reprisals, no sneak attack, nothing to fear, nothing to worry about. But we have to see this for ourselves, or else it just remains a hypothetical concept, like, well, maybe, but maybe not. But when we take a look, and that's called looking within, when we take a look and we see it, then we say, ah, okay, now I know. Now I know beyond words that this is so. All right. And then concepts back it up, but the seeing of it, the looking, the seeing, the willingness to see that is all important. That reality is not fragmented, it's all one. All of that, it needs to be seen, needs to be glimpsed, needs to be looked at. And the Holy Spirit is the great guide in the right use of time in each instant to help gradually guide us. Each one of us is unique. Each one of us is very unique in our defensive posturing. So the Holy Spirit works with each one of us individually to Help us to look and see. That's not something idols can do. Absolutely not. Idols say, don't look. Because if you look, you'll be annihilated. Don't look there, don't look there, don't look there, don't look there. As a matter of fact, be in such a chaotic state of mind, you can't look anywhere. That's what idols want. Idols want a chaotic state of mind. They want a chaotic state of mind. And you can feel the gathering chaos in the world. As people follow the lead of idols more and more and more and more, they're going more and more and more toward a chaotic state of the world. As a matter of fact, it's so easy now. There could be hacking in banking systems, which is what I believe is very likely to happen. What will happen is idols will give advice to those who follow them, who've set all this up, and they're going to collapse the financial system of the planet, and through hacking of computer systems, and bring about chaos, financial chaos, bring about World War III too. That's what idols want. They think it's salvation. And it's very possible now. The planet has never been remotely this vulnerable to total extreme chaos on the planet. Never remotely this close. Because so many people's entire lives, identity, financial identity, economic identity, personal identity, travel identity, identity to do anything at all is all completely electronic, is largely based on electronics, digital bits of data that can vanish into the ether instantly. So we've made we've structured, under the guidance of idols, we have structured the world in such a way that it's easy to bring about massive chaos on the planet. Easy. And there are cyber armies in the world whose sole purpose is to do that, actually. The sole purpose is to, at some point, crash the whole system. And it can happen, boom, like that. You know, it's not just denial of service type of things. It's other ways of doing it, where you just snarl the whole thing up, create just a total traffic jam, just this incredible traffic jam. All sorts of things are lost, and just the whole system just comes toppling down. So, they're working on that. Under the advice of idols, you see. Now, the Holy Spirit would not have advised, did not advise for any of this technology to go this direction at all, knowing exactly what the purpose of it was. Now, being that it's here, it can be utilized to warn people, for sure, which is what we're doing here. So, the relocation, the idea is to relocate and not get caught up in this chaos that's taking place in the world. Chaos brings about severe incapacity to focus on the message of the Holy Spirit. Severe incapacity. However, it doesn't. The Holy Spirit is still able to lead you out of total chaos. Absolutely, but it takes quite an effort. It takes some time. I've been through that. I experienced total mental chaos, and then I turned to the Holy Spirit, and I've been led out of that chaos. But it was very difficult. And no fun at all. So, it's a delaying tactic. There's a delaying tactic. This extreme chaos is just a way of delaying. It's a way of hiding for a little longer, you know, in your dread and fear of the Prime Creator. Believing the Prime Creator is trying to annihilate us, hunt us down. It's all a fantasy, no basis in reality whatsoever. The age of idolatry. We live in an idolatrous age to an extreme, horrendous, off the charts quantum extent. It's so pervasive. It's like we cannot escape it. We cannot escape it on this planet now. It's all pervasive. The attitudes have just become incredibly idolatrous. And of course, idols mock the Holy Spirit, mock those who dare to say, hey, you know, we don't need to listen to idols. They sneer, and they mock, and they jeer, and they insult, and they get angry, and all this kind of stuff. standard fare. That's one thing, but the chaos is a whole different level of problem. Whole different level. Where in order to listen to the Holy Spirit, it's good to have a very kind of a serene, calm, unhurried, peaceful kind of situation where you're able to just sit quietly and not worry about the world at all, not even think about the world, and let the world, all thoughts of the world, just seemingly recede into insignificance and unimportance, and then be able to focus your mind on clear thinking, clear reason, clear insight, clear seeing. So the more serene the external world is, and the less trouble it is, the better it is. And the more hectic it is, the more chaotic it is, the more frantic it is, the more of a rat race it is, the more of a divided, agitated, divisiveness there is, the more there's all the politics and all the name-calling and the struggles and all the battles and all this stuff, the more difficult it gets. That's why Jesus, when in studying A Course in Miracles early on, and he said, go, 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 go. You got to go as fast as possible. Don't let a single day get by without going as fast as possible. I said, wow, what's going on? I was aware, like, hey, there's trouble's coming. And in other words, you need to make hay while the sun shines. So when it's raining, it's too late. So I don't know how anybody, it's very tough right now. It's still, I imagine some places it might be feasible. I don't know, though. It seems like the whole planet's gotten so agitated that it's difficult for people to, I mean, I'd spend all day, every day, just sitting quietly and not even paying any attention to the world whatsoever. And just contemplating all day, reading or contemplating all day without a thought at all about the world. And nowadays, that's becoming more and more and more difficult, actually. And if you do that, you'll feel more and more isolated. So Jesus' point was, he said, hurry up. That's basically all he told me. Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. No slacking. Keep studying, no slacking. So I was able to get enough momentum going that I've been able to keep that going through these times, through this severe slide into idolatry, and I'm able to comment on this and see what's going on because of all the efforts I did back in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s when it wasn't quite as bad, before the technology came in. See, I did the work before the technology came in. So even though things were getting pretty terrible, it was still before all the technology came in, and then to just, you know, gave a quantum leap to idolatry. And where people said, hey, look what idols can do for us. How cool. How cool. What do we need the Holy Spirit for? That's old-fashioned. That's what they call it. That's fantasy, that's myth, that's superstition, that's patriarchy, that's, you know, all these words they use, the idols tell them. So idols give people vocabulary, they give them words, they use this word, you know, use this word to slander something, or use this word. And so there's so many of these words flying around now in the world. It's become part of the lexicon of the planet, the vocabulary of idols. Who, anybody who says, hey, wait a minute, these people are leaders of idolatry. That's not good. We don't like that. Oh, you know, then the idols condemn that. They condemn those people. People say, wait a minute, we don't want to throw out the baby with the bathwater, you know. And idols say, ah, you're a terrible, terrible person. And they throw these catchphrase, blanket, condemnation, words of condemnation towards those people. Just like when I was growing up in the 60s, the idols condemned those who warned us about this slide into idolatry. They condemned them, and very severely condemned them. The words weren't so vicious as they are now, but they were Old fogies, old fogies. What do the old fogies know? Man, those uptight, straight uptight establishment people. Totally uptight, unhip, unaware, unhip, uncool. Old fogies. And just whatever, we just, you know, disrespected and dismissed and smeared them and slandered them, etc. But nowadays, of course, it's even worse. It's so much, so bad now, it's ridiculous. People are saying, hey, wait a minute, this looks, smells, walks, talks, looks like idolatry. We don't want that. We don't want to slide into that. And then they get condemned, severely condemned by the idolaters. Those who are marching to the tune of idols, which is marching to the tune of the fear of God. Because there's many in the world who say, hey, well, we don't really fear God. In fact, we believe that God is not to be feared. And God is a God of love. There's no fear in love. We believe that God, there's no reason to be afraid of God. Whereas idolaters, are you kidding? Are you crazy? You know, they're so afraid of God, they don't even want to use the term. So they react with extreme anger towards those who are not interested in going down the path of idolatry. So you have these massive cultural wars that have been going on, severe culture wars over the last 30, 40 years, incredible culture wars, vicious wars between idolatry and those who really don't want to go down that path, or between those who follow the advice of two different idols or conflicting advice, because idols give conflicting advice because their purpose is chaos. So tell one group this and then the other group the opposite, and then watch them fight, you know. It stirs up conflict. Idols stir up conflict. I also say, God judges this as bad, and then the other idol go to another group and say, God judges this. No, God thinks this is great, but that is bad. And then you have two groups say, wait a minute, we're completely conflicted, and then they dogfight. So idols love to stir up dogfights. They love to stir up conflict, and they love to lead the world in frivolity. Idols, frivolity, all these distractions, frivolous distractions to distract people away from the sober, serious task and responsibility of listening to the Holy Spirit and considering what the Holy Spirit has to say. It's one thing to listen to the Holy Spirit. It's another to consider, spend the time considering what the Holy Spirit has to say and say, hey, you know, that. So I spend my time in consideration of what the Holy Spirit suggests as far as ideas and content of my mind. Mental thoughts will occur to me, and I'll say, huh, that's really a profound thought. I wonder where that came from. And it seems to come from me, but I say, you know, that comes from some wisdom, deep wisdom. Wow, that's amazing. So it comes from the Holy Spirit, actually. The Holy Spirit puts this wisdom into your mind, but it seems like it's coming from you. Holy Spirit's not trying to take credit for it. And then you consider this wisdom, and you say, wow, this sounds like it's very, very accurate and true. And so you spend your time getting used to it and considering it. Consider it. And then you lose your fear more and more and say, hey, I'm not afraid of these thoughts. I like these thoughts. I enjoy these thoughts. I want more of these thoughts. I am the holy self. I am the self. And the thoughts of the self are mine to use. Okay, the thoughts of the self are mine to use. So these thoughts from truth, from reality, from the Holy Spirit occur to us. And we then consider them. And then we grow used to them and say, these thoughts, I like these thoughts. And what the idols tell me, I don't like those thoughts. I don't like those. Leads into death and conflict. So we can say that I am the self. The self is what I am. The self, the true self. The true self is what I am. And the thoughts of the self are mine to use. Thoughts of myself are mine to use. My thoughts are mine. My thoughts coming from the self are mine to use. The thoughts of my true self are mine to use. I am the true self. I am the one self. I am the one self. The thoughts of the one self are mine to use. That's a lesson in A Course in Miracles, which is just simply stating what is true. And we need to do that, otherwise we'll use the thoughts of idols. And again, there is no third option. Thoughts either are coming from truth, or they're not coming from truth. They're coming from hypotheticals. Either thoughts come from the real, either thoughts are representing the real, or they're representing the belief in impermanence. Either thoughts representing the knowledge of permanence, or they represent the belief in impermanence. There's no other option. You can't have it both ways or neither. You can't have neither or both. It's not possible. Yet idols tell you that you can, just so that you don't choose truth. Idols say, okay, reject both truth and idols. That's their answer. Now that leaves you in a state of chaos, of just pretending to not be interested in any thought at all. You're unable to think, even. You feel unable to think at all. Trying to please both idols and the Holy Spirit, you end up in this chaotic state of not being able to think at all, hardly. And that's what idols want you, where idols are taking the world, this chaotic state. So we're at the point in history right now where the situation is likely to get exacerbated to extreme extent, and the relocation is coming up soon. Relocation is something that people should at least consider and get used to the idea. Like, you know, it seems like a good idea, because when this world is going to become again plunged into chaos, and we don't deserve that. Those aren't the thoughts of ourself, the thoughts of God, the thoughts of the Holy Spirit, not at all. That's the advice of idols. We don't need to follow idols just because we made them to as a sort of a server, as it were, full of advice. Like we have a server and we program the server full of all this advice, and then we click for answers and it gives us these answers, and we think, oh, the server is so wise, it's giving us the answers. No, we programmed the software for it, and it's giving us this advice now that we programmed into it, and yet it seems to always be there to give us this advice. And this advice is based on the fear of God, which is based on ignorance and pride. We don't need to follow that advice. We don't need to continue to listen to idols. We don't need to put ourselves in situations where we're getting pressured to listen to idols. That's what's happening in the world now, is the marching orders are going out from the top down, from those who are extremely loyal to idols, and they pass that on to other people slightly lower, and they pass it on to others, and they can pass it on. It's like a whole chain. There's a whole hierarchy of people, of minds that are loyal to idols, and the message, the guidance, the advice of idols is passed out and disseminated throughout society, throughout culture, throughout the world. Absolutely. And then it's picked up by all the idolaters in the world, and then they resonate and amplify it out more and more and more and more and more and more and more. It's like everybody is listening to some song, and everyone has this device that they listen to the song, and they listen to it more and more and more and more and more, and then they hold the radio, whatever is playing, MP3 player radio, and say, hey, listen to this song. Everybody say, hey, everybody, listen to this song. You gotta listen to this song. It's great. And after a while, you know, everybody's listening to the song. It's being played at all the sporting events, all the concerts, all the stores, all the buses, public transportation, schools, you name it. Everybody's listening to the same song, right? And then everybody's getting indoctrinated by the advice of idols. And it doesn't matter whether you claim one idol or 1,000 idols. It's the same thing. Same advice. Same advice. It's not some great step to say, well, I'm only listening to one idol. Well, it's the same advice. The same advice. So these are the crazy times that we live in. And those who believe that they have to stay in this world, of course they're intimidated and their hands are tied, as it were. And they say, well, we've got to find a way to get along with idols somehow. We've got to follow their advice somehow. Only those who feel like, hey, they're not going to be here, can speak out. This way that I'm speaking out. I speak out this way because I believe I'm going to relocate. So that I'm not worried about the future here on this planet or what my future would be on this planet. I'm not concerned about it. But the reason why others don't speak out is they think, well, I've got to somehow get along. How am I going to get along in this world if I don't bow to idols? You know, it's practically impossible. But if you knew that you were going to a place that was much, much less intimidating, where idols, where the spell of idols is nothing but a dim memory, then you wouldn't feel so frightened, so intimidated. You say, why should I worry? That kind of thing. And of course, then we think, well, yeah, but what if I don't go? Then I'd really be in trouble. Now, yeah, that is true. So, hopefully, relocation will take place. It's certainly been promised to us. Just like the Israelites, the Jews left Egypt. There's Exodus. They were let out of Egypt because they were told, hey, chaos is coming. You're in big trouble. You need to get out of there. So they left. They left. Went to a different... They relocated to a land of milk and honey, as it were. So we've been given a great promise by Jesus that he will help relocate us. Those who are on the path of listening to the Holy Spirit and forsaking idols, willing to drop the advice and guidance of idols altogether at some point, that they're going to be helped during this time which has been foreseen of global control by idolatry. So it is nerve-wracking. It's difficult for people to listen to these videos because they think, oh my gosh, I could get in big trouble for that sort of thing. But that just goes to show, doesn't it, how terrible idolatry is. One has to keep faith. One has to say, hey, I'm not going to be pushed around. I'm not going to be pushed around by idols. I'm going to... there will be a way. There will be a way. So I keep getting reassurance about this. And I say, okay, I'll keep working on this. Otherwise, it'd be crazy to keep working on it. But I keep getting clarification and reassurance. And the message is, keep working on this relocation, message of relocation. Keep focusing on that. And again, that's in the face of virtually all spiritual teachers on this planet. I don't know any that are speaking about relocation, really. So it flies in the face of that. But that's been explained also. It's been explained also that I've said much of the spiritual teaching on this planet is a compromise deal with idols. It's a compromise deal. So that's allowed to function here. because it doesn't really bring about the remembrance of God. It doesn't really solve the continuity problem. It's like Christianity took over the festivals of the pagans, and the pagans converted under the sword, of course. When they got defeated in battle, they then said, wow, you got some kind of power. We want that power. See, that's most of the conversions happen that way. Was that in pagans and in war and battle, defeating your enemies, all important. And they worship might and power and all that, conquest. So when someone else comes along and defeats them, they thought they were invincible, and they pray to all their gods, idols, about how to win in battle. And then someone comes on along and defeats them. They say, oh my gosh, these people have a better, stronger idol than we do. Stronger idol. Who's your idol? They say, who's your idol? And the conquering armor would say, well, we fight under the cross or something. They say, wow, you got a better idol than we do. Okay, we're going to worship the cross. We're going to accept that. We're accept your idol, because that way we'll be invincible in battle. So that's the way conversions happen, by and large. And so these pagans brought all their holidays and festivals, pagan festivals, with them, and then the Christians said, well, hey, look, we'll let you keep all the festivals and all this stuff. We'll just rename them. Rename them. So there's a sense of continuity there. But real followers of the Holy Spirit are not converted due to losses in battle or anything like that. It's because they get a glimpse, they're willing to look for a moment at truth. And they say, ah, truth is true. No worries. Truth has no worries coming from dreams at all. And then seeing that, they say, wow, I got to listen to the guidance that helps me accept this permanently. That's the one who's really following Christ, really following the Holy Spirit. And that can be done wherever we are. That can be done, but we don't want to backslide at this point. We don't want to backslide, and the world is going into such a situation as possible that we could backslide severely. Very possible, very likely. If we remain on this planet, it is the likelihood of backsliding and lose and giving away all the progress we've made towards finally accepting the vision of timelessness, that could be given up. We could backslide, which would be, you know, tragedy. Very, very much of a tragedy. So I keep advocating a relocation, even though it's not traditionally being advocated at all in the world right now. And, you know, I let each one be accountable for what they advocate. Those who are not advocating at all, well, that's up to them. That's up to them. I'm not going to follow their lead by refusing to speak on this. Because, of course, by not doing that, they get along with idols a whole lot better. All right? And more people come to see them, more people pay attention. They say, oh, this one's kind of a blend between truth and lies, or you know, idolatry is acceptable here, you know. They say, oh, okay, that's cool, that's great. I can pretend to be interested in liberation, freedom, but I can still follow the advice of idols. And they say, oh, that's a great compromise. And so these people will attain a great status in the world, and people will listen to them, and you know, they go on a spiritual ego trip that way. That's okay. But we don't have to follow that lead. We don't have to follow that lead. You know, talking about relocation is not taboo. It's not taboo. Why should it be taboo? Why should it be taboo when Jesus' parting words were, I'm going to prepare a place for you, a dwelling place for you, and then so that I can come back at the end of the age and take you to that dwelling place to dwell there with me. Those are his final parting words. So why are we not considering those parting words as very, 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 very important words? Why? And he said, don't lay up your treasures in this world. Forget it. Focus on the dwelling place that is to come. In other words, this other dwelling place, this relocation. And yet now we're thinking, wow, this world is so much fun, so wonderful. We can have so much fun here. Fun, fun, fun. We can sing and dance and dance, 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 dance. And we're going to fix all the problems of the world. Everybody's going to be happy. We're going to all live happily forever after. We'll all be empowered. We'll all be all blah, 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 blah. And yet all the while, there's this rigid hierarchy structure being put in place in the world. Very, very rigid. You don't have a prayer of going up that ladder unless you bow to idols to an extraordinary extent. And you have this unprecedented takeover of the media and information and communication networks of the planet by idolaters, severe idolaters, who are extremely loyal to idols. Complete, massive takeover. It's been a blitzkrieg that's taken place in this planet. And it's now its occupation. You know, it's occupied. Occupied by idolaters. And so you, what kind of freedom do you have? What kind of fun do you have? What kind of, you're not able to function, arise, and have any status in such a system at all. So it's not fun at all for many people. It's terrible, actually. And it's really terrible for everyone, because idolatry leads to conflict. And you can tell that the level of conflict now in the world is off the charts compared to what it used to be, just in terms of personal communication between people. People are now easily willing to hurl the most vile insults at each other as if it was no big deal at all. No big deal at all. You can see the level of enmity in, like, in the Middle East, how people generational grow up to have this just, you know, incredible vile hatred of one another. It's just amazing. And that's spread throughout the world now, where in the past, you know, you just you know, follow the lead, like, of Krishnamurti. Growing up with that, it's like you treat everybody as a very respectful, respected, and cherished, precious, valued mind, valued aspect of spirit, and dialogue was courteous, respectful, and courteous, and people were not so afraid to disagree. And if there was, there were not epithets hurled at them. But we have sunk down now in the world into this morass of incredible hostility towards anyone who might have a different opinion. Of course, there is truth, there's Holy Spirit, and idolatry, which is mistaken. And this needs to be pointed out and made clear and unambiguous, etc., etc. But we don't have to do it in an insulting manner. We can do it in a matter-of-fact manner. And we respect those who are still hooked into idolatry, knowing that they will get free at some point. So there's no hatred there. Just like a little child, your child's in the sandbox saying that, you know, they're destroying your house, and you don't hate them for that. You realize that they won't always be playing with these, you know, childish games. You say, okay, you know, you're not ready to give up the childish games yet. That's okay. No judgment. No judgment. We don't judge that. But we're aware of it. And we sidestep it. But as far as judgment goes, it's not like a moral judgment upon people. Sure, they're all messed up, all confused, and going into extreme darkness. But that's, hey, free will. That's their free will to do that. They have a right to do that. So certainly we respect that fact and respect the whole situation. And also we respect our choices, too. Our choice to get free of that, to sidestep it. So it is a struggle to continue to focus on what's relevant. Every day it becomes more difficult. Every day on multiple fronts, there are decisions and directions being taken which are wholly given over to the vice of idols every day. And it's not even worth paying attention anymore. It's very disheartening to see this. Whereas if, again, if you feel, talk about relocation, consider relocation, you say, well, it doesn't really matter. To me, to those who want to follow idols, they think it's great. I mean, most of the world thinks they're going in the right direction. Most of the world believes that it's going towards salvation. Yeah, it's quite something to convince the world as it goes into the jaws of death that it's going towards salvation. Of course, we tell ourselves that death is salvation. In other words, by dying, we escape annihilation. Escape annihilation is a way of hiding from God. You say, hey, God, we tell God, hey, God, this body is what I am. And then, oops, this body died. It's no more. Oh, guess what, God? I'm no more. You can't find me. All the while knowing that a body is just like a meat suit that we put on. It's not us at all. But we're it's a way to calm our fears, thinking, hey, God can't find us. We're in the afterlife now. But God's thought we were a body, and so body disappears, it's dissolved, we're safe. So death tends to, we try to sacrifice something to save the rest, thinking that we need to do that in order for our hiding to be better hiding. So the world, idolatry welcomes death. It welcomes all this destruction. It welcomes it. It thinks like, hey, God, look, everything, we're all gone. We're all destroyed. Give it, you know, it's all done. The job's done. And you've had what you wanted. So it's all finished. And now we think, oh, we can now hide in the afterlife somewhere. Yeah, and God doesn't even know we're hanging out in the afterlife. He thinks that we're all dead. God thinks we're all dead. This is just, of course, just arch foolishness. Arch whimsicality, eccentricity, totally ridiculous. I get the afterlife is just hypothetical too, just imagination too. God's not looking for us. God's not trying to find us at all, because God knows where we are. We're in reality. Where else could we be? There's no place other than reality. Hypothetical land is not a place. It's a what if, imagine what if scenario. It's not a real place at all. It's not a real situation at all. So we've never left reality. So God's not looking for us at all. We're just pretending that God isn't looking for us so that we can try to decrease our fear. Because the fear of annihilation is intolerable. So we just conjure up all sorts of quirky little formulas that we think reduces our fear. So God's looking for us, but what we are is gone and died is no more. Therefore, God searches futile, can't find us, and then now we're safe, you see. And then after a while in the afterlife, we start realizing, uh-oh. It seems like God is still looking for us. So what do we do? We need to have another body and convince him even more that this body is what we are, and that with its death we are no more. We are destroyed. We've been annihilated. So God got what it wants. We're annihilated. Game over. God needs to stop seeking for us. And then again, we hang out in the afterlife, and after a while, we start feeling again, hey, oh my gosh, God is still not convinced that we're dead, so he's still looking for us. Because what we're feeling is our own reality is still there, totally. And that makes us feel, uh-oh. There's some awareness that we're still didn't die, you know. So all this is grist for the mill. Put it in the mill. crank the bell, and make some bread out of it. The more I focus on relocation, the more clarity I get. And I say, hey, Holy Spirit, speak to me. Speak to my mind about relocation. Speak to my mind. Whatever you want to say, speak to my mind about relocation. I'll listen to whatever you have to say. There's an openness, a willingness. Say what you want to say here. Because I do see the persecution coming in the world. The chaos, the persecution. It's already, people are already being severely persecuted. Severely persecuted. You wear like a, you can't wear a t-shirt to school, you know, with a cross on it or Jesus or something religious. There's so many restrictions now towards anything that goes towards the Holy Spirit that might lead people to the Holy Spirit listening to it. I say, oh, people say, oh, what is that? Maybe they're a Christian, you know, can't wear that at school. Whereas people can wear all these other t-shirts with stuff, the slogans of idols, you know, that's no problem. They can have tattoos of idols suggested to them. Hey, idols suggest, hey, have this tattoo, you know. And dress this way and wear this kind of clothing and do this and this. Now, that's okay in school. That's perfectly fine. No problem there. You know, but anyone who gives any evidence of interest or loyalty to the Holy Spirit is persona non grata, dangerous, needs to be sent home, needs to be expelled. And now this is just seen as just the obvious thing, because again, people follow the vice of idols. They believe the idols are like God, like their authorities are righteous and true and are leading them in the right direction. So they don't question it. They don't question it. And idols hate to be questioned. So they refuse. They don't question it. It's something that should be, they claim it's all self-evident. All the vice of idols, idolaters claim it's self-evident. And so there is no real dialogue. They just say, well, why should we talk about anything that's self-evident? Which is true if the vice were true. What is self-evident doesn't need to be talked about, but the advice of idols is not self-evident at all, so it should be thoroughly vetted. Idols hate to be vetted. Hate to be vetted. And insist, don't question their advice, don't vet it, don't look at it, don't consider it, just follow it, just do it, that kind of thing. So, you have situations where people who follow idols just say, oh, you know, it's just every, why even think about it or consider it in any other? We just, this is all self-evident. Of course this is right. Whereas it's obviously not right at all. So there's no real dialogue. It's imposition. It's an indoctrination. It's not an education. The world is not being educated at this point. It's being indoctrinated. There's no education going on. Real education is to listen to the Holy Spirit and consider what the Holy Spirit has to say to you. Because that is a true education. Having done that and comparing it against the education that I was brought up on, comparing the two, I say, wow, obvious one is a complete fraud, complete fake. The other one is obviously completely true. Right use of time, the other is wrong use of time, waste of time. So most education in this world is a total waste of time, really. In terms of what is truly valuable, which is to escape hypotheticals, set down hypotheticals, because hypotheticals are a nightmare. It's a feeling of just complete instability, like the bottom can drop out at any moment, no matter what you do in hypothetical land. We always have the feeling the bottom can drop out at any moment. Always. Always, always, and always, which is why more is never enough for idolaters. It's never enough. They have to have more. They have to have more. It's never enough. Just a minute here. More power. It's never enough. They want more power over you, more power, more power, more power. They want to be able to say, hey, all, everything, don't question it. It's all self-evident. It's all completely obvious. It must be true. And they don't want you to engage in this consideration like, hey, wait a minute, let me look at this. The Holy Spirit wants you to say, hey, let's just A-B this. Let's compare it. Let's take a look at this. Let's consider it. Go through a process of consideration. Take a careful, close look. Holy Spirit doesn't insist that you accept what it says like that, you know, without evaluating, without looking at it, without considering it. It says, consider this, consider this. Give your time, give yourself time to consider it. Because it's not worried. It knows it's true. So it knows that after considering it, you'll agree. You'll say, hey, yeah, this is true. So the agendas of the idols, the idolatrous agendas in this world, they're just imposing their will on people. They've already decided this is self-evident truth. There's no discussion. It's just they're right and you're wrong, and they're pressuring you to admit that you're wrong and accept their self-evident truths like that. Without discussion, without true debate, without truly vetting the whole situation at all. At all. It's amazing. The social trends in this world, how that we're just being told that this is right without any genuine debate at all, because the idolaters are not willing to say, okay, let's look at this, let's in truth, let's just look at this situation. Now, if you have already considered the truth of the Holy Spirit, then you do realize what is self-evident and what isn't. What is and what isn't self-evident. So at some point on that path, there's not a necessity to debate, constantly debate. That's a waste of time. But for those who are still uncertain, you need to, and it's especially important to the vice of idols, it is important to look at that and say, hey, wait a minute, you know, not so fast. This feels like we're being forced. This is being forced on us. You're being told this is the way you have to think. This is what you have to believe without any evidence at all, you know, just because it's the right moral, righteous position, because idols have said so. Again, we want to believe that idols are God, and therefore to question God seems to be, oh no, we can't do that. So what idols tell us, we're supposed to just accept without question, and then tell everybody else, hey, this is the truth. You have to accept it too. Otherwise, you're against truth. You're against morality, and you're against everything that we should be for. And you're a very, very wicked person because of that. And if you don't agree at some point, eventually, you're going to have to pay the price for being so wicked. This is the way of the world at this time. Very unfortunate, but it is the way of the world. Now, we agreed to come into this world in the way of the world, arriving through birth and growing up, etc. But we didn't agree to leave this world in the traditional way of dying, etc. Not at all. I never agreed to that at all. I did agree to come here. I came here, but I didn't agree to leave this world in the traditional way, which is death. Absolutely not. It's very important. People think, oh, well, you got to follow the advice of idols, which means you got to die. No, I'm not following the advice of idols. For the sake of compassion and help in this world, we come into the world in a normal way. You don't have to. I mean, you can literally manifest a body here if you want to. Absolutely, just manifest a body. You don't have to go through birth here. But most people will not recognize you unless you go through birth. But as far as relocating, you don't have to die to relocate. That's nonsense. Only idols would say such a thing. Because again, idols' death is all important to them. That's their device, their cloaking device, their hiding device. So it's super important. They think, see, whatever God created is gone. So God will have to stop looking for it. Again, God is not looking for life, because life is perfectly apparent to God where God created it. It hasn't, life is not separated from itself at all. So there's no need for any search at all. So these days are very important to ramp up your efforts, to continue to consider advice and talk that defies idolatry, defies idols, and says, no, forget it. I'm not going to capitulate to that, and we'll, if and when we leave, we'll leave on our own terms, not on the terms of idols, okay? We will leave on our own terms. We'll relocate on our own terms. And we will simply wait until the dogfight dies down and then assess things at that point. But when idolatry plunges itself into chaos, it doesn't serve any purpose for us to be there, because you really cannot be of much assistance at that point in time at all. It has to play out, and people have to say, you know, get that bitter taste in their mouth. They say, wow, that taste is so bitter, I want to get rid of that taste. And then they turn to the Holy Spirit. They reject idols, for at least momentarily. They say, wow, forget idols, that we were misled, we were deceived. And then they say, is there something else other than idols? And then the Holy Spirit is there. It's always there. And the Holy Spirit responds by giving them, saying, look at this, look at this. That's how it was with me. There was no grand entrance or anything. It's just a subtle little feeling like, I need to look here. Let me look here. It was just like a sort of a subtle, gentle impulse. Let me pay my attention. I said, let me put my attention here. And then I did. And when I did that, it's like, huh? I saw something. I said, how did I miss that? That's always been there. I didn't see it. That's very strange. And then again, I had this subtle feeling like, let me put my attention here. And I would. And then again, another something like, wow, I didn't see that before. Well, how come I didn't see that before? It's amazing. And then just many, many thousands of these little events of just your attention, shifting your attention over here, and then seeing something and looking and saying, I see that. And then seeing within, shifting your attention to these thoughts and this train of thought and this concept, etc. Gradually, you begin to lose your fear of looking at what is most important to look at. And that's the way of the Holy Spirit. That's the path. And the path of idolatry leaves you with the most incredible bitter taste in your mouth, leaves you with ashes, you know. And then at that point, you'll say, okay, Holy Spirit. I mean, you'll say something, help. I need help from something. Holy Spirit then is there, because you're rejecting idols. You're saying, no. I can't take this. It's too terrible. But that has to play out, unfortunately. It has to play out for most people. They're going to continue to follow idols until they get that bad taste in their mouth. And you think you'd be able to tell them, say, I can see what's going to come. Why can't you see it? And they say, no, idols told me not to look. So what do you do? They're not willing to look. It's a catch-22, isn't it? I say, if you just look ahead, you'll be able to see what's coming. So you say, I don't want that. And they say, oh, what are you talking about? No. I'm going to be loyal to idols. And they told me not to look, because they say they're here to save me. And if I look, I might not be able to follow their advice anymore, and I wouldn't be saved, and I'll be annihilated and all this stuff. And I say, no. It's idols that are trying to annihilate you, trying to bring you into chaos. They're the ones. And if you look, you see that no, God has a perfect plan of salvation. It's already accomplished, and we just need to accept it. You know, they won't listen. So it's very frustrating. It's a catch-22. Very frustrating. And the Holy Spirit knows that. The Holy Spirit knows that the situation in the world is very difficult. So I'll continue to pay attention to what the Holy Spirit has to say. And we'll see what happens from that standpoint. That's the best that we can do. So consider these words, and consider this, and look at it, think about it, consider it. Just consider it. No one's saying you got to accept this. You can't look at it. You can't think about it. You can't agree or disagree. You can't just consider it. Process it. That's fine. That's fine. Just take it under consideration, this information from these videos. All right, that is enough from now, because I'm experiencing a poof, energy drop at this point. That's it. Very great.